Now, why is health research linked to humanitarian crises or disasters is performed or needed? Health research linked to disasters expands our understanding of the short-term and long-term effects of these events. But it's not just understanding, and it's not just describing the effects. It's also aiming at the design and implementation of interventions that strengthen preparedness and reduce the impact of these events. For instance, the National Institute on Environmental Health Sciences has identified some short-term benefits of this type of research. And they include accurately characterizing the scope and nature of exposures of concern, understanding acute health impacts, identifying vulnerable populations, improving worker safety, determining effectiveness of interventions. They have also identified some long-term benefits from this type of research, and they include improved understanding of the delayed and chronic health effects from exposures and other disaster-related risk factors, increased community resilience, expanded knowledge of the effectiveness of medical countermeasures and other mitigation strategies, and improved health system preparedness, response, and recovery for future events. Some of these benefits reflect an environmental health perspective. We could add improved understanding of the long-term effects on health in general, and specifically on chronic health conditions. Also, the long-term effects on healthcare systems and interventions that improve preparedness plans that ensure the continuity of care during disasters. One of the consistent observations in humanitarian crises and disasters is that communities with the lowest resources tend to experience the greatest impact of these events. In addition, those very communities may not be as prepared for the disasters as they could be. Therefore, they could be at the highest risk for both short-term and long-term impact and the intensity of the disaster, but also at the highest risk of the longest and slowest recovery. Metrics to ascertain vulnerability to the impact of disasters have been proposed. And here I am showing an example from the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, the CDC, and which designed the Social Vulnerability Index. And with the purpose of identifying communities at risk of experiencing greatest impact and needs. And the Social Vulnerability Index, as you see, includes four dimensions: a socioeconomic status of the community or the households that are in that community, the household composition, and people within the household who have disabilities, whether the individuals who live in that community belong to a minority group, or if they do not communicate in English very well, and housing and transportation characteristics. Here, this is an example on how the Social Vulnerability Index has been used to map characteristics of the communities affected by natural disasters. And in particular, this is an example from Hurricane Sandy from 2012. Hurricane Sandy hit New York and New Jersey very strongly. And in this map, this is part of the coastline of New York. We see that the number of inundated schools, and the schools are the red dots, and the number was greater in communities where the concentration of African-American individuals, human beings, were living. So it's one of the measures of vulnerability. In this other example, This one is from Hurricane Harvey in Texas in 2017. We see how the social vulnerability index overlaps with the water depth, with the flooding that happened after, during and after the hurricane. For instance, with the medium social vulnerability, there was a significant overlap in areas where the water depth was the deepest or the highest, I should say, and where the high social vulnerability index with the medium area, so the medium height. So it's showing how the socioeconomic characteristics of the communities and other characteristics overlap with the areas where most of the damage or where the risk was the highest. Although this model includes multiple criteria that would help identify communities with greatest vulnerability, other factors could also increase this risk. In this example, this is a diagram from research after Hurricane Maria in Puerto Rico in 2017. And the investigators used the social vulnerability index, but they also included the municipality annual debt as a factor. They also included some physical vulnerabilities, for example, the risk of landslides or flood in the area, and the number of households who requested individual assistance from FEMA. So that helped them, that kind of algorithm or the sum of these two types of vulnerabilities helped them identify those municipalities with the highest risk. The National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences, along with North Carolina State University and Texas A&M, collaborated on the creation of this vulnerability index for COVID-19. In this vulnerability index, the team pulled different sources of information and which you see along the borders. I hope you can see my cursor, the mouse, along the borders of the scorecard. And these sources of information correspond to a slice of the actual vulnerability index. And there are 12 components that they assessed. In this particular example, in the selected district right here, in that area, the vulnerability was highest for two items or for two domains: social distancing and residential density. The size of the slice is going to tell you the intensity for that particular component. As you remember from the lecture on research in health disparities, the health status and health outcomes of individuals is influenced by multi-level factors, which they also interact among themselves, and biological, psychological, sociocultural, socioeconomic, cognitive, and health system factors and other factors influence health. And they may influence health with different intensity or at different times, but also their influence varies with time and along the life course. Then those factors, the individual factors, are also affected by other factors outside health and healthcare. For instance, infrastructure, education, recreation, and government policies, housing, all of this is going to also impact or influence the health and the healthcare of the individuals and the communities. And within this context, a disaster hits, and it definitely is going to affect every single one of these sectors. So when we think about research and when we think about assessments on the impact of disasters to a community, to a country, to a region, we need to think beyond the individual household, the individual community, and think about the big picture and other factors that could influence health.